taken place on September 21st with Jim Carl, P-51 Fighter Ace. Jim, I'd like to start the interview off by asking you, where were you when Pearl Harbor was attacked?
I was at my home. It was on Sunday in Quapaw, Oklahoma. And I enlisted. It was on December the 7th, but I didn't enlist until December the 27th, which was on my mother's birthday. Mm-hmm. And when I enlisted, I was sent to Sherman Air Force Base for basic. And I went through basic. That was in January, I think, of 42. And after I finished basic, they sent me to an airplane mechanic school on base there. I didn't like it, but I went. And after that, I was assigned to the 12th Bomb Group at Esler Field, Louisiana, which was right out of Alexandria, Louisiana. And from there, they sent me out to Mines Field, California, to attend B-25 Flight Engineering School. And while I was there, I got yellow jaundice. And when I made it back to the outfit, I ended up 43 days in Camp Livingston Hospital, and my group was scheduled, was packing for deployment to North Africa. My 12th bomb group, my old original outfit, was the first bomb group to go to North Africa. And when I got out of the hospital, I was got to come home for a week. And then my next duty assignment was at Barksdale Field, Louisiana, flying. And there, they sent me to a B-26 flight engineering school. And I was assigned to the squadron commander's airplane. His name was Captain Keene. And I had about 450 or 500 hours as an engineer on the B-26 Marauders. And I always wanted to be a fighter pilot. While I was there, they come out with a competitive examination for West Point. And at the same time, I made flight school and I made West Point. Captain Keene called me into his office and congratulated me upon my appointment. And I said, well, I'm not going. I'm going to flight school. And he told me that I didn't have any sense. And I agreed with him. So anyways, I went on to flight school at Eagle Pass, Texas. And, well, I'll take that back. I didn't either. I went to primary flight school at Bonham, Texas, and then I went to basic flight school at Sherman Air Force Base, and then I went to single engine fighters at Eagle Pass, Texas, and I graduated out of Eagle Pass. I got to fly P-40s while I was in school. And when I finished there, they sent us to Waycross, Georgia, to a top gun school, flying P-40s. And while all of us guys were there, we were married, because we knew we were getting ready to go overseas. And we left, and we all volunteered, not all of us, but a lot of us volunteered to join the 354th Fighter Group, which was an all-volunteer group, and they were in England at the time. I had never flown a P-51, had never been around a P-51 at that time. But we embarked from, I think it was New York Harbor, I think it was, and we ended up in Glasgow, Scotland. And they took us by train to Northern England, to a little town. I'm trying to think of it right now. But anyways, that's where I got my training in a P-51. And that was just before the invasion. And Goxhill, England, G-O-X-H-I-L-L. Had, after we finished our training, the outfit had gone, my outfit, the 354th Fighter Group, had gone to Cherbourg, had been transported over there to the continent of France. And that's where we joined them. And we followed basically the Third Army all the way up through the war. But our main deal was to go up against German fighters. And I'm not bragging when I say this, but in the 18 months that the group was in combat, I wasn't in combat 18 months, I was in combat a year. And during that time, the group shot down 701 in the air confirmed, and we lost 63 people from combat, weather, and mechanical. About the time that this thing was over with, I had a lung collapse. They call it a spontaneous pneumothorax, and I ended up back at Camp Group, Camp Neil Show, Missouri, the camp up there. I can't remember the name of it. And I was in there 2 or 3 months, and they shipped me to Air Force Hospital in San Antonio. And I didn't get out of the hospital until February the 8th of 46. And after that, I was still flying a while, and then I had an opportunity to get out. I'd had it, and went in civilian life, got me a job flying, and I flew there for quite a while at Telequal. I was head of the flights program over there. And then I was in a plane crash there, and I ended up with another year in a hospital. And after I got out of there, I was had an opportunity to join the highway patrol. So I was a state trooper for 2 or 3 years, I guess. And I had a chance to join a finance group. And I joined them, the Beneficial Finance Company. And I spent 25 and a half years with them. And that's basically, after I retired, I've just been kind of knocking around, not doing anything particularly. Still do a lot of flying.
Do you mind if I ask you a series of questions about your time in the service?
No.
Going back to training, you started off as a flight engineer, and you would have been the rank of?
Buck Sergeant, first.
And then, could you explain what this competitive examination was that allowed you to go from an NCO to be an officer and ultimately a fighter pilot?
Well, no, the competitive examination come out, it wasn't nothing but an examination.
Yes.
And it was written and all this good stuff.
Yes.
And I don't know how many people was accepted, a bunch, I imagine. But I chose to go to flight school other than that.
But would you say that that's kind of a non-traditional path, though? I mean, typically...
It wasn't a normal thing back in those days.
Yes.
It wasn't, and I don't know why they did it. I mean, I don't have any reason to know why they did it.
I mean, was the test designed to maybe pick out people with exceptional aptitude that maybe weren't typical college students that still had the what it takes to be a pilot?
When you go to West Point, you don't go up there as a pilot.
Yeah.
You know, that's a four-year degree school. And I had no desire to go. Now, if I had not made flight school, mm-hmm. I would have went. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to be a fighter pilot. That's all I ever wanted to do.
Could you describe the first time you flew solo in an airplane? Do you remember that during training?
Oh, yeah, I remember it real well.
What was it like?
It was the greatest thing in my life.
Yeah.
You know, I had about 8 hours. We were flying inline engine, Ranger engine, 175 horsepower, PT-19, and it was great. That's where you cut your teeth, and that's where a lot of people washed out.
Really?
A lot of people washed out of flight school.
What part of flight school was most difficult?
The academics. The academics. It was tough.
Yeah.
I had taken shorthand when I was in high school, and I really believe that if I hadn't had shorthand, I would have never made it academically.
Really?
But I took all of my notes in shorthand, and that of a night I'd go down in the latrine area and transcribe the notes, and that way I remembered it.
Yep.
So it was kind of an easy thing for me.
You also mentioned that initially you were flying P-40s. Could you describe what the flight characteristics were of the P-40?
Well, the first time that I got to fly a P-40, we had some P-40s at Eagle Pass, Texas. But what we were training in down there was the AT-6, which was radial engine. Mm-hmm. And I had been up on an instrument check ride. And I had come down and was standing beside of the airplane with my this lieutenant who had given me the test, telling me that his son could fly better than me. And that was a normal thing. And they called my name out to report up to the P-40 squadron. And he said, "Are you going to get to fly P-40s? And I said, "My instructor had recommended it." And the first time I crawled in that bird and was taxiing down the runway, I was so shaky my feet was hitting the rudder pedals, not looking out over that old long nose. And I made a good takeoff, but I didn't do anything in the air. The airplane was literally flying me around. And when I got out of there, when I got finished there, I had 63 hours in that airplane when I was still a cadet. So when I got into Waycross, Georgia, I still didn't know how to fly the airplane. So there was a fellow there, I never will forget him, his name was Lieutenant Cleveland. And Lieutenant Cleveland had flown everything in the world. He was a real hot jock. And I went to him and I said, "Lieutenant," I told him my history in the airplane, that I didn't feel good with it. And he said, "Well, how would you like to fly? I mean, learn." I said, "That's why I came to you." He said, "We'll check out two airplanes and we'll go down from Waycross, we'll go down to Del Mabry Field, Florida and pick up the mail." We had no mail service. And he said, you forget your instrument panel. I'm going to fly your airplane." And when we took off, I slid underneath him and it was aerobatics all the way down there. Everything that you can do in an airplane, we did all the way down there and all the way back.
So is he talking you through certain things?
No, you don't just talk you through. You just look at his airplane and do what he does.
Got it.
There's no conversations.
Got it.
And when I came back, I was ready to go into combat in that airplane.
Really?
It was a World War II P-40s.
So you felt a lot more comfortable in
that airplane? Oh, yeah. I mean, I knew how to fly that airplane. It was the same thing that General Chenault's people flew in China. Mm-hmm. Same airplane.
Yep. So after you had been trained to be a P-40 pilot, once you transferred overseas, how did you fly overseas? Did you take the boat across?
Took a boat.
Could you describe the transit across?
I can't remember the name of the ship that we went on, but I do know it was English. Mm-hmm. And I do know that we had beans for breakfast a time or two. And I also remember that this old band leader, Spike, what was his name? Crazy guy. He had a band, and he was on the ship with us. But it was a non-eventful trip over.
Okay.
Non-eventful.
Could you describe what the base in England was like initially? I mean, what were the? Did you have a chance? Did you spend much time in England before you made it over to Cherbourg? No.
No.
Could you describe what it was like going from the P-40 to the P-51 in terms of how the airplanes handled?
The old P-40 was a good, stable old airplane, but the 51 was a piece of work. I mean, it was an art. Yeah. It was a joy to get to fly it.
Yeah.
And it cruised out about 425 miles an hour, fully military. And it was something that you dream about getting to fly. And I was very fortunate that I got to fly the airplane in combat. And it matched up real well against the 109s and the 190s. And
did you give your airplane a name?
The Quapaw Squaw.
Nice. Okay.
I'm from that little town of Quapaw, and I named it the Quapaw Squaw.
Good. Once, could you describe what the living conditions were like in Cherbourg? What was the base like? You know, what was the weather like?
We had tents.
Yeah.
We had tents, and it was we had moved in a little ways, and it was an old grass field that went across the main highway, and it had about a 10 or 15 degree angle to it, and I mean, you literally had to fly the airplane, but we, like I said, when the Third Army moved up, we moved up. Not right behind it, but in the close proximity to it. That's really about all I can tell you.
Okay. What about, could you describe how many missions did you fly, and what sort of missions did you guys fly? What was the sort of day-to-day work that you were responsible for?
Well, I had 86 combat missions. And like I said before, our main deal was to try to go up against the Luftwaffe. But when we found no airplanes, we normally carried two 500-pound bombs with us. And we'd go in and bomb just targets. Mm. And then when we did that, we would look for targets of opportunity, and we did strafing, trains, anything that moved. We went and got. Mm-hmm. I've got my combat film.
Do you really? So you actually have some gun camera footage still?
Yeah.
Could you describe some of the targets opportunity that you helped dispatch during the war?
The hardest target to go against was an airfield. They were heavily fortified, and you normally only make one pass across it. Mm. Because It was a little bit raunchy.
Yeah.
And I had rather go into an aerial situation than I had a strafing run across an airfield. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Did you, how effective was ground fire at taking, did you guys lose a lot of planes to enemy ground fire when you were taking out targets of opportunity, or were you able to?
We lost some.
Did you?
Oh, yeah. We lost them.
Okay. Do you remember your first combat mission?
Yeah.
Could you describe what you felt?
I was flying wing to a fellow named Pop Young. We called him Pop because he was 25 years old. And I was flying his wing, and that's the first time that I'd seen all the flak. And I thought to myself, there ain't nobody going to get out of this alive. I mean, it was that thick and that bad. Well, Pop got engine trouble and had to return to base, and I escorted him back out. That was the procedure. Mm-hmm. But that was my first mission that I flew.
Were you nervous?
No, I don't think I was.
Okay.
I don't think I was. I was a little apprehensive that to seeing all this any aircraft fire. It just looked like you could walk on it. It was so thick.
What about the first time that you came across German fighters? What was that experience like?
That I got to mm-hmm. do the firing?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah. It's, you know, it's, you welcome the opportunity.
Yeah.
And,
how many aerial victories did you have during the war? If you don't mind me asking.
Oh, not many.
Not many? Were there certain tactics as a P-51 pilot that you could employ against enemy aircraft that were more effective than others?
Oh, not really. We did what we call a loop scissor, and if it got on your tail, but normally we were never in a combat situation in the air that we wasn't outnumbered. Mm. I don't ever remember one case where we wasn't outnumbered. Mm. And in a way, that was an advantage to us.
Yeah.